Today, I might be challenging some of you on how you've always looked at evolution. I invite you to come along with me and explore some of the pivotal conversations amongst evolutionary developmental biologists. The concepts are not new and have been debated between philosophers long before modern science. The paper written by Stephen Gould and Richard Lewontin in 1979 reignited a lot of this conversation. And of course, the paper I'm talking about is The Spandrels of San Marco and the Panglossian Paradigm. Let me start by asking you a question. What is common between spandrels and feathers? Spandrels are triangular segments situated between the arches and under the domes of structures such as cathedrals. I'll let you ponder on that for a while, and hopefully the answer may become clear in the next few minutes. If I say Charles Darwin, the first things that may pop into your heads may be natural selection, survival of the fittest, and maybe an image like this one, where ape becomes man. Darwin was famous for introducing the theory of evolution through his book, Origin of Species, in which he discussed natural selection as the main driving force of evolution. Adaptationists extrapolated from this that natural selection is the exclusive driving force that lead organisms to evolve into the optimal forms. Gould and Lewontin, on the other hand, expressed that this viewpoint is flawed. They compared adaptationists to Dr. Pangloss, an overly optimistic fictional character from the novel Candide, who believed everything was made for its ideal purpose. Adaptationists tend to dissect organisms into traits, which are then assessed individually for their stories of selection. They believe the current form is the direct result of the selection process. Gould, on the other hand, emphasized the necessity to analyze organisms as integrated wholes. He also stated that Darwin himself had a pluralistic approach and how important it is to consider alternative forms of evolution. To illustrate this, imagine a terrain like this one. Adaptationists see the process of evolution as a mountain, its peak being the end point of adaptation, and its trajectory always heading towards this point of optimal fitness. Pluralists see a terrain perhaps more like this one. The process of evolution is under different types of influence, sometimes random, sometimes not. It can head downhill or nowhere. It can also lead from one peak to another. An integral concept that comes into play is constraints. At times, a character can never reach its optimum due to obstacles of either genetic or epigenetic in nature. Let's go back and talk a bit more about evolutionary processes other than natural selection. An interesting question is, what defines adaptation in the sense of natural selection? Does it simply involve the survival of an organism, or does it also involve reproduction to pass on its genes and traits? In this paper, alternatives discussed include traits resulting from neither adaptation or selection, traits resulting from indirect selection, traits resulting from one but not the other, and vice versa, traits resulting from both but with no basis for distinguishing the difference between adaptations. And lastly, a trait resulting from both adaptation and selection, where adaptation represents a secondary use of an existing trait. This is later termed exaptation. Let's finally answer that question from earlier. Spandrels and feathers are both examples of exaptation. They are byproducts of existing adaptations which have been put to another use that is beneficial. The spandrel, which critics later pointed out should have been referred to as pendentives, is a necessary architectural byproduct when mounting a dome on rounded arches. Artists then saw decorative opportunities, making spandrels features on their own, resulting in what inspired Gould at San Marco. As for feathers, they were initially adapted for the purpose of thermoregulation. Later, it became an exaptation for catching insects by increasing the hand surface area before eventually becoming an exaptation for flight. Selection is indeed a powerful driving force in evolution. However, it is absolutely crucial to not overlook other agents which shape and influence traits. This iconic paper has caused a lot of controversy, but also a lot of lateral thinking. I hope this video has sparked some creativity and encouraged you to think outside the box when critically appraising any scientific topic. I'll leave you with what Stephen Gould has once said. Science is not a heartless pursuit of objective information. It is a creative human activity. It's geniuses acting more as artists than as information processors.